You know, we've sang so much, I'm about to get hoarse. It's really funny. It ain't funny, but it is kind of funny. What I'm going to do is I'm going to tell you about me. This is the first conference that I've led off with a concert. And if you think I'm nervous, you're right. I mean, when you're sitting here and Richard Jordan's sitting in the back of the room, you better behave yourself. Richard and I met a few years ago, Richard, in North Carolina. I can't think of the name of the church there, that they had a conference, and I sang a little bit during the thing. Yes, Royal Grace, that's right. And I was singing for a guy that he was one of the best Bible teachers I knew at the time. And I led out for him, and he ended up being a universalist now. So Richard, if you go universalism, I quit. But anyhow, I hate that, but it's just the way it was. The first song I'm going to do is a medley of some old gospel songs, and I'm going to tell you how I did this. My grandmother, years ago, she had fallen and broken her hip, and they asked me to come sing for her. And so I went over to her house and set up in her house with something kind of like what I've got right here. And I got to turn this thing up some. So I got to singing these songs, and my grandmother got up out of a wheelchair. She had broken her hip. She got up out of her wheelchair and got to clapping her hand and patting her foot. And I thought, if my grandmother liked that much, the next weekend, I took me a machine to a nursing home just below St. Vincent's Hospital in Birmingham. And I got in there and I got set up and I had some of them doing this. And I had some of them doing this. And I had some of them doing that. So what I'm saying is I'm going to try to get this sound to where y'all can hear it okay. But how many in here over 29 years old? You're going to recognize some of these old gospel songs. By the way, I want to say this. I have a CD that I've had for quite some time. I wrote the one song I wrote on it. It's called The Gospel of Christ. All the other songs are not, quote, doctrinal songs. And the people that I go sing for, I'm going there to be able to give them the gospel. That's my mission. That's what I'm all about, and that's my guitar right there. That's what I'm all about, is getting the gospel to all those that may not have heard it. But anyhow, you're going to recognize some of these old songs. Now, you sing along if you want to. I don't think we have any rules against that, do we, Lenny? All right, here we go. This is a gospel medley.
Oh, they tell me of a home far beyond the sky. Oh, they tell me of a home far away. Oh, they tell me of a home where no storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of an uncloudy day. Oh, they tell me of a home where
I sing Christmas songs. So I'm going to sing your Christmas song. And it's one that was actually recorded by a group in Fort Payne, Alabama. This is called Christmas in Dixie. Tell you this at the beginning as well. If you have any request, if you'll just write it on a $100 bill and send it right up here, I'll get my guitar and try to do it at least. Now, listen, there's an old Baptist hymn, Mansion Over the Hilltop. Anybody remember that?
Oh, yeah.
Well, I got a guy that I sing with, been singing with him for about 40 years. And he heard this song and he said, let's do this. Let's soup it up a little bit. So Ed Jones got a hold of it and he souped it up. So this is Mansion on the Hilltop. Now I got to tell you, we were singing at a church and I told the kids that were on the front row, I said, now when we get to Over the Hilltop, if y'all just help me now to get over the hilltop, Ed Jones got a $100 bill for each one of them. And boy, them kids start doing all that, and we got through. I said, all right, Ed, pay them. He said, I can't do it. I said, why not? He said, they used the wrong arm. So he got out of it. But hey, you know, that's the way it is. But this is Mansion on a Hilltop. Told you to suit up. I'm satisfied with it. Just a cutty below. A little silver and a little gold. But in that city where the ransom would shine, I want a gold one. That silver line. I've got a mansion just over the hilltop. In that bright land where we will never grow old. And someday yonder we will never go wander. But walk the streets that are filled with gold. Though often tempted, tormented and tested, and like the prophet, my pillow was stone. And though I find here no permanent dwelling, I know still in this country. Y'all proud to be American? Let's hear it for our troops. How about that? All those out there that is listening to this, God bless you and thank you for serving this country. The one group that I still sing with on that guitar is called Homeland, and we've been blessed. We've been able to sing all over the country. We sang for the Joint Chiefs of Staff in D.C. for over a week. We were in the bottom of the Hilton where Reagan was shot. And down at the bottom of that, I was on a stage that came up out of there. And, you know, you ended up there. And I looked out there and saw all the Joint Chiefs and all those senators and congressmen. And I thought, I just don't want to pinch myself. I thought, how did this old boy from Alabama get here? But listen, every time we go, we get a chance to mention Jesus. If we can't do that, we won't go. And so anyhow, I want to do a song that was written by a guy named Lee Greenwood. Anybody ever heard of him? Yeah. Well, Lee Greenwood came out with this song back when Ronald Reagan was running. And I believe it'll be around for a long, long, long time. I hope it is. But on the third verse of this song, we had a guy that sang with us, actually helped start our group, the Bridge Builders. His name was Ranger Gary Horton, and he would travel around the schools, high schools, public schools, and talk about all the problems, the drugs, sex before marriage, and all the things that went on in those schools. But he not only would talk about it, he would share the Lord Jesus Christ with them. And kids getting saved in those high schools. Now he has gotten on up into age, but the third verse is one that we put in here. Lee Greenwood. Lee Greenwood says, I thank my lucky stars. I said, I thank the grace of God. Amen. I always tell everybody I'm American by birth and Southern by the grace of God. Now, Richard used to be, I think he's from Mobile, so he's all right. Now, that is a joke, by the way. I'm thankful we're all Americans. That is a joke. But anyhow, I'm going to do one, God Bless the USA. It's one of my favorite songs about the country. If tomorrow all the things are gone, I'd worked for all my life, and I had to start again with just my children and my wife. Thank the grace of God to be living here today, 'cause the flag still stands for freedom, and they can't take that away. And I'm proud to be an American, for at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I'll gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. From the lakes of Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston, from New York to LA, there's pride in every American heart, and it's time we stand and say that I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I'll gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. Ranger Gary Horton. You may ask us why we've come here. It's to teach you all we can. You see, we love this blessed country, and it needs our helping hands. But only in God's Spirit and His truth within our soul can true freedom be won again, and our story can be told. And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I'll gladly stand up next to you and There is a, the guy that I sing with, it does a lot of stuff. He has a studio in his basement. That's how I get the tracks that I sing with. There's a John Denver song that's about his wife. He wrote about his wife. You Fill Up My Senses. Anybody remember that? John Denver? Any John Denver fans in here?
Yeah.
All right. Anyhow, what this did for Ed was the Lord for him. This first part, it just meant something to him about that. And then he put blessed assurance with it. And I like the way he did it, so I'm going to do that one for you. It's called Annie's Song. You fill up my senses like a night in the forest, like a mountain in springtime, like a walk in the rain, like a storm in the desert, like a sleepy blue ocean. You fill up my senses.
Thank you.
right. I'm watching my watch. Won't mess up, go too long, Lenny. You won't have to get that hook and drag me off of here. One of the things that I wanted to say about what I do is for a long time, I was with, you know, raised Baptist, like I said. And during that, you know, during all that, I'd go to church and the preacher would preach something and, you know, I'd be convicted and down the aisle I'd go. And as a matter of fact, we wrote a song about what all I did in the Baptist church. I was president of the Brotherhood, president of the youth committee. I had a Sunday school class. I drove the church bus and I did all the maintenance. And I thought that was going to get me good with God, you know, but it didn't. And so we wrote a song about that. It's called Hell to Pay. If you don't trust Christ as your Savior, you're going to have hell to pay. So anyhow, part of that song is, I walked those aisles 1,000 miles. I got baptized 26 times. I got baptized twice. Had a Church of Christ guy, I said, Larry, you got to be baptized for the remission of sins. I said, brother, let me calm you down. I've been baptized twice. He said, yeah, but not for the remission of sins. I said, are you saying I got to trust in my baptism? He said, yes, I do. I said, our conversation is over. So anyhow, what I try to do, being raised Baptist, I went from Baptist to a group that I love, still love the folks in it. I was saved in that group because that pastor was the first pastor I heard give the gospel of Christ. And I trusted, I believed it for my salvation. And so anyhow, I got into a seminary with them. I went to seminary for 5 years. It wasn't every day, but it was. They brought in the Greek and the Hebrew folks and all that. I learned some Greek and I learned some Hebrew. Let me tell you what I remember in the Greek. O eis I amen eti ousi. And that's tenses of verbs and stuff like that. But I never got into right division until I was working for a company called Rust Engineering. And with the Greek now, we would take the Greek and show you where you were wrong. And in Acts 2:38, where it said, Peter said, repent every one of you and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. Well, that Greek word for is the word eis. And it can mean other things, like with a view to. And what Peter said was be baptized for the, but that ain't what he meant. We told you what he meant. So anyhow, this little guy named Cecil Fulmer, and I love him dearly, thank God for him. He was in the corner, and we were in a dark room where we're starting to do computers. This is back in the 1990s, about 96. And I was telling this guy, listen, what Peter was talking about is this and that. And he stepped up and he said, Larry, he said, what God was doing was on the cross, Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And in answer to that prayer, he was offering Israel as a nation to repent as a nation. And he was making that offer. They crucified the Son of God, would not accept him, but in his heavenly abode, he was offering another chance for Israel. And boy, it was like somebody threw water on me. I said, where'd you come up with that? And he said, well, it's called 2 Timothy 2:15. Study to show thyself. I said, well, I've never heard of that. And so anyhow, he got me some tapes. Some of them was from a guy named E.C. Moore. Anybody remember E.C. Moore? Anybody know E.C. Moore? And some of them was from a guy named Richard Jordan. Anybody remember a guy named Richard Jordan? And I listened to Richard, and I'll tell you, Richard, I am so thankful for you and what you've done. I will tell you, the fold-out that you have right there that you, I think, came from you, didn't it, Richard? I want to tell you that when I saw that, and the guy was trying to explain to me that about this, Cecil was doing that, and he opened that thing up and he talked about right division. And he showed me how that thing was and how that Jesus was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. I'd never heard that before. And it was not meat that he should give the bread to dogs. And that, you know what gives me chills is that woman said, "Yea, Lord, but even the dogs get the crumbs." I'm going to tell you something. I like to choke when I heard that. But anyhow, he opened that thing up, and I opened it up with him. And he said Israel would not repent. And if they had, they would have gone into the tribulation period. And then you have, you know, Jesus coming back to earth and all how it goes. And he said, but they wouldn't do it. So God, in his infinite wisdom and mercy, he gave grace to a man named Saul of Tarsus. And when he opened that thing up and that yellow stuck, I felt like I got saved again. I mean, that is the best visual aid that I can do. If somebody doesn't see that, I can't help them. I've gone beyond what I can do. But I'll tell you, there's some great, great Bible teachers out there, and I am so thankful for them. But what I do, and when I get to the end of my time, and I'm about to get to the end of the time here, is I'm gonna give you an example. I did a memorial for a good friend of mine's wife passed away. I know he's saved because I've given him the gospel. He trusted it. And I know I don't know about his wife, but we were in a very fancy place in Birmingham. It was in a place in the golf course was really something, and they had they had food and all that. And they wanted me to do the memorial, and so I sang a couple of songs. And I said, look, I don't know any of y'all in here. I know a couple, but not most of you. I don't know what background you come from. I don't know what you believe. And I'm not here to push you about that. I'm here to share with you that which I've also received. And I said, if you look at Romans 1:16, Paul said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ for it. He doesn't say for he. He says for it is the power of God and the salvation to those who believe, referring back to that gospel. And I said in Ephesians 2:8 and 9, Paul said that we're saved by grace through faith, that not of ourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any of us could boast. And then, so what I'm going to tell you is, you can tell me how I feel or whatever you think, but I'm going to tell you, the Apostle Paul said, he is the Apostle, Romans 11:13. He said, he was the Apostle to the Gentiles. He said he magnified his office. And he also said that he is our example, and we are to follow him as he follows Christ. So 1 Corinthians 15 is, and I just listened to it, Richard's message on that. You were a little bit younger back then. But and I don't mean that in a bad way, because I ain't getting no younger either. So anyhow, the gospel in 1 Corinthians 15. First of all, 1 Corinthians 15, when Paul says moreover, 1 Corinthians 15 is clearing up the issue of the resurrection. And when, so what Paul was saying to those that were believers in Corinth, I wish I had it here to read it to you. He said, "Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you." Which you look it up, Lenny?
Yeah.
Anyhow, y'all all here know, but in case somebody's watching on the thing, I'd love for them to know. Anyhow, he said, "Whereby you've received, wherein you stand, and wherein you are saved, if you keep in memory what I delivered unto you, unless you believed in vain." Now, there's those out there that thinks believing in vain is they just didn't believe it. Thank you, Lenny. Thank you. Where am I going to put it? Let's see.
Put it below the microphone.
No, it's good. As a matter of fact, I've got to the part that I want to hear. He said, "I preach unto you which also you received, and wherein you stand, by which also you're saved. If you keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless you believed in vain." And that believing in vain is, some people think, well, they just didn't believe it. Well, these people Paul were talking to were believers. They are brethren. They had received it. They were saved. Believing in vain is if Christ is not risen, then your faith is vain. And he talks about that down about verse 15. He said, "For I delivered unto you." Now here's what I'm saying. I'm delivering unto you. Now I know y'all are saved here, but "For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received." He's not delivering something that Christ gave him, said, "Here, take this and go deliver it to everybody." Paul was the first one to receive it and to be saved by it. He's the first one in the body of Christ, at least that's my belief. "How that Christ died for our sins according to Scripture, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to Scripture." And then he stopped there, and there's a colon there. And he went on to say that Peter and all these other brethren or folks saw Jesus. Peter preached he was raised, but he didn't preach he was raised for our justification like Paul did. So if you believe that gospel, you simply trust it. You know what you're doing? You're trusting in Christ. What I'm afraid of is there are people out there that say, "Well, Larry, the gospel is the death, burial, and resurrection." Yes, it is. Now trust Christ. Well, when I believe in the death, burial, and resurrection, I am trusting Christ. That is what I'm trusting. That's the power of God and the salvation to those that believe that gospel. So anyhow, I've got another minute. Well, I don't want to get behind schedule, but I will sing another song here. This is a song, I'm going to do one more Christmas song. Then I'm going to do a song that I wrote. Have I got time, Lena? I don't think I have.
Yeah. Go for it.
Go for it?
Yeah,
go for it.
Okay. And this song is really true. Thank you, Lena.
Yes, ma'am.
If every day was like Christmas, what a wonderful world this would be. If just believing in Jesus saves you, and I believe there's people, I agree, there's, because, you know, most everybody believes in him. But do they believe, most of those people that believe and say, well, yeah, the death, burial, and resurrection. I'm going to give you a quick answer to that. I got a good friend that his brother was getting on up in age. And he said, "I want to know if you pass away," they lived in different states, "are you going to heaven?" He said, "I sure am." He said, "Are you saved?" He said, "I sure am." He said, "Well, I want to be sure. Do you believe that Christ died for your sins?" He said, "I sure do." He said, "Do you believe he was buried?" He said, "Yes, I believe he's buried. Most dead people are buried." He said, "Do you believe he was raised again for your justification?" And he said, "There ain't nobody ever come out of a grave." Now, you tell me, is that man saved according to Paul's gospel? Because Paul said Jesus Christ was raised again according to my gospel. And believing that, if there is no resurrection, I am the resurrection police. If there is no resurrection, there is no gospel. If there's no resurrection, you ain't saved without believing it. I'm sorry. That's just the way it is. That's the way God designed it. His death, burial, resurrection was not a mystery, but what Christ gave Paul, that we would be saved by believing in that death, burial, and resurrection, that we would be baptized by the Holy Spirit into his body. Oh, you can't get no better than that. Now, I'm not going to be able to sing the Christmas song. Or I may just not sing my song.
Oh.
Huh? Which one?
Your song.
Okay. Jerry, I don't know if Jerry, can you hear me? I'm going to sing this one. This is one Jerry likes. This is the song that I wrote. And I wrote it a while back. And I ain't got it here. Where is my song? Golly, I'm sorry. Cut the cameras. No. Golly. Let's see, I want to sing that. Here we go. I'm sorry, y'all. Here we go. This is one I wrote called The Gospel of Christ, taken out of Romans 1:16, Ephesians 2:8-9, and 1 Corinthians 15. The Bible says that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not counting our sins against us. He made Christ, who knew no sin, to be sin for us, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Jesus Christ, both God and man, died, was buried, and rose again. He died for our sins upon that tree, and rose again for you and me. If we believe that gospel true, eternal life he'll give it's the power of God unto salvation. Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
Thank you. Well, I've got 3 minutes. Can I do that real quick Christmas song? I love this song. Have I got 3 minutes? 3 minutes and you're going to get some good teaching. Here we go. This is called If Every Day Were Like Christmas. I changed the thing to find my soul. Here we go. Here we go. This is it. I love this song. And I hope you love it. Saying Christmas is near, they ring out to tell the world that this is the season of cheer. I hear a choir singing sweetly somewhere, and a glow fills my heart. I'm at peace with the world as the sound of their singing fills the air. No, why can't every day be like Christmas? Why can't doors right back yonder. It's a cardboard box. And you open it up, there's CDs, because I had people say, well, you're going to bring CDs. And how much are they? I don't sell them. If you want to put money in the box for it, because I buy more to give out, then do that. If you hadn't got any money, get you one anyway. I got some Christmas CDs in there. And if you ain't got any money, get you some money out. It don't matter. So anyhow, it was great being with you my first time. Could be the last. I hope not. But it's first time to sing at the conference. And I'm proud to be here with all you rightly dividing folks that love the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you.
Thank you.